Welcome to the American Campfire Revival tonight. You know why we're dancing? Because our chains have been broken. Because we have been set free. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to gather together, Lord. And I pray that this will be a time to where we come before you, Lord, and worship you. Lord, because you have truly set us free from our chains. And I want to thank you for that, Lord. Even if it seems like we haven't been set free physically, you have set us free spiritually, Lord. And we gain so much because of that. I'm thinking about the verse, Lord, that says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? But Lord, because of you, we have not lost our soul. We have life, and we can know you. Lord, help us to take a step of faith to trust in you and your plan and what you have to say. In your holy name, amen. All right, guys, so welcome to the American Campfire Revival. We are going to be reading Galatians 5. I don't know why, just this verse was kind of highlighted to me in my Bible. Another thing, because I highlighted it a little bit while ago because I was studying it. But I'm going to break it basically down into three parts. First part is Christian liberty. Second part is love fulfills the law. And the third part is walking in the Spirit. So first part, we're going to be talking about just starting at the beginning, because you know that's what you do. So, chapter 5, verse 1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty, in the freedom by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. We have been set free from our chains. God has given us the opportunity, the free will, to choose whether or not we want to have faith and trust in Him and walk with Him and not rely on ourselves. He's given us that opportunity to choose what we want to do. Because He wants a genuine relationship with us. And that takes faith on our part. We have to come before the Lord and humbly surrender, which gives us life. It doesn't take it away. It renews it. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made you free. And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. And this is kind of the next part. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. You have become estranged with Christ, who you attempt to be justified by the law. You have fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, eagerly wait for the hope of the righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor non or uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love. So this is a passage all about faith. Perfect for the week when God is pointing out to me faith to share with you guys. The first thing I want to point out, or that God has shown me to point out, is that because Christ has set us free from our chains, we don't have to change our physical because He has changed our spiritual. But when we look to Him, because He's changed our spiritual, He changes are physical. By that I mean fruit is produced within us, as we'll read later on in this chapter. But by looking to God, by living with Him, by aligning ourselves with Him and His will, He changes us for the better. If you go down to verse 4, it says, "You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace." This verse makes me think of, let me see if it's right here. If it's not, it's all right. Nope. But it makes me think about how we can never be good enough to save ourselves. But do you know who can? Do you know who is? Not us. Correct answer. No, you probably may or may have not thought of Jesus. Jesus, He came, He lived a perfect life, He sacrificed Himself and defeated death, overcame the grave, so that way we may know God and have a relationship with God and have life and have it abundantly in faith. It only takes a mustard seed of faith. Because once that seed is planted in the soil, we'll say this is the soil, this is the seed. Once you plant that seed in the soil, it begins to grow because you are abiding in Jesus. He is a living water that waters you and allows you to grow. Yes, sometimes there's healthy boundaries around it, but that is to protect you, just like a garden. You who have become estranged from Christ, you attempt to be justified by the law, you have fallen from grace. Are you trying to justify what you did wrong? Or are you looking to Jesus, who through Him we can know God, and through Him God sees us as clean? All we have to do is be willing to have the faith to accept that. I have faith in that. Do you? If you go down to verse 5, it says, "For we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith." By faith, we eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love. And then the next part is talking about love fulfills the law. You'll have to come back for that tomorrow night. But is... okay, I'm going to go in a little ahead. It goes down. If you go down to verse 22, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love." Love is a fruit of the Spirit. And faith is working through love. At the same time, we have to have faith in order to abide, in order to come before the Lord and humble ourselves. A verse I may or may have not said before, I've said it, is 2 Chronicles 7:14. "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." Do you know how much faith it takes in order to humble yourself? And once you humble yourself, you pray, you seek God's faith. And when you do that, He hears from heaven and He will forgive our sin and heal our land. Do you know how much faith that takes? How much faith are you putting in? It only takes a mustard seed of faith. All you gotta do is come before the Lord and have faith. And He has confidence in you. He has confidence that He can trust you. You know why? Because He has already trusted you with what He has given you. It is simply up to you to bring it before Him so that way He can plant it as a mustard seed of faith. What has He given to you? What has He given to you that is not, that you are not giving to Him, not as a sacrifice, but in obedience? Yes, the obedience may require sacrifice, but in obedience, not out of a fear of death, but out of a love of life. You can have a reverent fear. You can have a respect for Him, but that's because of the life He gives. We need to come before Him. We need to humble ourselves in faith. 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 And faith. Are you coming before Him in faith today? Here, a real fast verse. He who receives me, this is Matthew 10, 40. He who receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And he who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones only a cup of water in the name of a disciple, assuredly I say to you, he shall by no means lose his reward. If you are receiving, if you are able to be receptive, if you have open hands what God has given to you, then you will receive. I'm not trying to preach a prosperity gospel, because ultimately we don't need to follow Christ if we're expecting to gain physical wealth. Following Christ does not always mean being physically wealthy and healthy. But spiritually, He brings life. He defines. And once we die, our body will be dead, obviously. But our soul will continue to live for eternity, either in heaven or hell. But don't be afraid. Don't choose to surrender and have faith because you are scared of death. Rather, do it out of a thirst for life. Jesus is the only one. He is the living water who can satisfy that thirst. Are you looking to Him to satisfy that thirst? Or are you looking to yourself? It takes faith to look to Him. It takes faith to start a revival. It takes faith to come out here and plant seeds. It takes faith, personally for me, to come out here every single night. I know it takes faith for Kirk Cameron, and I'm so happy that he's doing it. I encourage you to go watch his. His is awesome. If you aren't already watching it, it's available on Facebook every single day until 100 days are up. Who knows? He may even go a little past. But he's doing it out of faith because he trusts and he's humbled himself. Kirk Cameron, I kind of feel like he's a good example of what it means to start something in faith. He planted a seed of American Campfire Revival, and he inspired me to do the same. Faith not only affects you, it affects others around you. Others will see results. Others will see your fruits. And correct me if I'm wrong, but love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. Faithfulness is a fruit of the Spirit. Another thing I want to say real fast about the fruit of the Spirit while I'm thinking about it and talking about how we cannot earn it on our own. The fruits of the Spirit are not a requirement for what we need to have and what we need to do in order to get to heaven. Rather, it's something that we can point out and see as a result of living with God. It's actually nothing. We can't do that on our own. But it's an example that God gives us to show us who He is. And to be frank, for anyone who doubts, it is an example to show us that He exists and that He is God. He is already God. We are simply acknowledging it. And the fruits of the Spirit are one way that we can actively see His presence. Fruits of the Spirit are not something that we work for and try to do on our own. There's something that comes as a result of living and walking and knowing Him. And we do that because of Jesus. Because Jesus humbled Himself. And we have to humble ourselves in order to accept His life that He gave, so that way we may know God. And the reason why that's significant is because even though He gave His life, He didn't lose it. He defeated death. Faith. Faith is, I feel like the best way to say it is, a mustard seed. Faith is a mustard seed. You gotta take it, you gotta plant it, and let God do the rest. There's a movie called Faith Like Potatoes. I'm not saying go watch it. I'm not saying not to. But it exists. I would say go watch it, but I watched it a long time ago and I don't exactly remember how it goes. So I'm just going to say there's a movie called Faith Like Potatoes. And I kind of remember the plot, but the guy, he plants some potatoes and they end up growing up. And I mean, like they do. Like, oh yes, my little potatoes. Yes, good boy. No. But the potatoes, they grow up, and, or I guess they grow, not grow up. I mean, they are growing up. Nope, they're actually underground. That is the cool thing about potatoes. That's where I was messing up. Because you have to have faith that the potatoes are there, even though you can't see them. And this is actually really cool, because it's kind of going with what we were talking about the other night, how even though we're obedient, we may not always see the results immediately. But it doesn't mean that the results aren't there. So I guess, overall, bottom line for tonight is once we have just a mustard seed of faith and we look to God and give it and surrender it to Him, He helps us to stand free in the liberty which Christ has made us free. So, yeah, I just think that's really cool. And a country we're going to be praying for tonight is Afghanistan. I just really feel like we need to pray for them tonight. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to pray for them. We're also going to pray for you guys. So let's do it. Dear Heavenly Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for allowing us to gather together, Lord. And I pray that we would live in faith and surrender, Lord, the mustard seed that You've given to us, so that way it may grow. Lord, thank You for this opportunity, Lord, to come and out in faith, Lord, and speak to these individuals. I pray that they would soak in the words You spoke through me, Lord. Thank You for this time, and I want to pray for Afghanistan, Lord, and all of the chaos there. And I pray for wisdom and guidance for the Christians there and those who are being persecuted, Lord, and that You would give them comfort. In Your holy name, amen. So, two things before I go. One of the reasons why I like to pray for the countries is because, the Bible tells us to not to forget to pray for our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted. And two, because I believe it helps illuminate how truly Christianity is not a prosperity gospel. I just want to emphasize that. If you look at all of the disciples, or I believe all of the disciples, maybe most, they died. Well, they died, yes, but they died gruesome deaths. I believe John was just left on an island, which is why I was like, yeah, but being left all alone is pretty lonely, but yet again, he wasn't alone. And that is where the true wealth comes in, a spiritual wealth that comes from planting a mustard seed of faith. In heaven, the currency is faith. So, just want to encourage you with that tonight. I'll see you guys tomorrow night. Thank you so much for watching American Campfire Revival. I hope to see you guys again. Adios.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of